Good afternoon and welcome to Driver's Ed, our fourth day into the Driver's Ed program. So as we normally do, let's take a few minutes to sign in. Make sure you put your name in the comments. Make sure that you text me that you are joining today's session. If by chance that you can't make it live, make sure that you do view it this evening and make sure you get caught up in your assignments and your homework. So let's just wait for a few moments for people to log on. Good afternoon, Seth. Nathan. Zach. Hope. Andrew. Connor. Jason. Charlotte, Brady, this is good. Everybody's getting on right on time. As people join in, remember chapter 5 is what I wanted you to have completed, so make sure those chapter questions are done. The other thing is I text images. I've got them on the screen right now of car symbols. This is where we left off from yesterday's class, talking about car symbols. So if you did not get this, make sure that you just come back to today's class and freeze this frame and look at the pictures or text me and let me know that you did not receive these and I'll get them out to you. Basically what we want to do with the symbols here, and I want you to get out your notebook and your pen and pencil to write down a few things about the symbols and about the VIN number. And you guys have been doing fantastic. With your homework, I cannot tell you how impressed I am with the thoroughness and your dedication to get it into me in a timely manner. This is one of my better classes in a long time, with great content and work and being spot on with your answers. So you guys are doing a good job. There's a few people that got to do a little bit better, but we'll try to higher the bar in the next coming weeks with Driver's Ed. Well, anyways, let's talk about the symbols for a moment. It's important that you try to get as many as you can. If you can't get all of them, I understand. Some of them may not be the same as your car manufacturer may be using, but it's close enough that you should be able to guess. So if you have a few blanks or if there are a few that are wrong, I really don't care about that. But what I want you to write down is that your instrument panel, just like we were talking about a pilot flying a plane, that when you're driving a car, your car is speaking to you through your gauges and your lights. So when these lights and gauges start moving, you better be looking down at your instrument panel every once in a while to get this information, or else you're going to be driving into problems. So this is what I want you to write down. Anytime that you see a yellow light, it's a warning. It's telling you that you should know that something's not quite right or something's activated, but it's not an emergency. The color red, and we'll be talking about this next week, anything red in driving, signs, traffic lights, instrument panel lights, anything that's red is immediate attention. This is something that you've got to be paying attention to and understand it could be a serious problem, and you're going to have to take care of it right off. So that's what I wanted to do with these symbols, to kind of get your mind thinking that when you see these things, that I've got to contend to these as I drive. I will look through chapter 3 and 5 probably tomorrow or Saturday to make sure people have their work in. I'll let you know if you're still missing something. A few of you are doing a little bit more than you need to, and that's okay. I appreciate that. But really, the chapter tests are at the very, very end of each chapter. It's multiple choice, fill in the blank, or match A. So some of you are doing some of the projects or review questions. That's good. It's still showing me that you read the material and you're answering them correctly. I like that, but I don't want to bog you down with all the work that you have to do. And let's just kind of get to the bottom of probably what's on everybody's mind. We are officially going to finish driver's ed online. We are not going back to the high school. Apparently this afternoon, Governor Sununu came on TV and announced that school is over. No more coming to a classroom for the rest of the year. And I think most of us kind of knew that. But here we are. Now, the next roadblock that we have and we've got to overcome is basically, when will the state allow me to get you in the car and start driving with you? So cross your fingers, say your prayers, whatever you need to do to get this thing moving so we can actually complete you and get you licensed, hopefully by the beginning of summer. So let's try to focus on that. So I think, and on the manual, okay? If you cannot find any of your answers for the symbols, remember, go back to your manual or Google, okay? Because you're home alone and doing a lot of this work, it's pass-fail. If you have to talk to other people in the driver's ed class because you're just not getting a question or you don't know what one of these symbols is, it doesn't matter to me right now that you're asking for help. I just want you to understand things and know what things mean. So whether you get it from me in our sessions here in the afternoon, or whether you get it from your parents, or whether you get it from friends, the most important thing is that you're gaining information, you're gaining knowledge, and it's going to make you a better driver. So that's what we want to accomplish. So pass fail for driver's ed. All right, let's get our notebooks to a blank piece of paper. Let me get out of a few things here. And today we're going to focus on safety equipment. So yesterday we were talking about different gauges and lights and controls of the car, our seat. We talked about carjacking. So we covered a lot about the vehicle. Now we're talking basically about what should we expect from the car manufacturer to make us a safe driver. How are they protecting us? So in your notes, what I want you to write down is that not all cars are created equal. Okay? Not all cars are created equal. What do I mean by that? What I mean is that cars are built to certain specifications, and when they're brought out to the general public, they have to meet certain standards. Now, within those standards, some excel in what they're providing for safety. Others, not so much. So in your notes, what I want you to write down, every car has a car rating, which means an independent group has gone out, tested your vehicle for its trustworthiness of how it will protect you. Now, when you go out to buy a car, you're going to probably be thinking about, what does it look like? What is the horsepower? How comfortable is it? What are the features of the car inside the car to me? But I want you to write down in your notes, the most important thing is car safety. That should be at the very top of your list when you're thinking about buying a vehicle. And for most of you, it's probably going to be a used vehicle. So as you go out looking for a used vehicle, go to, I'm trying to think of the website. It is Carfax. Will give you some information about what your car, if it's a used vehicle, what has happened to it, accidents and repairs and things like that. But safercar.gov, safercar.gov. And I'll try to put that on a link for you. And we'll probably do some homework when we talk about insurance. But I want you to write down your notes. Insurance is based upon you as a driver and the type of vehicle that you're driving. So a lot of times when you purchase a vehicle, used or new, they're going to ask about some of your habits. Do you always use your seatbelt? Do you make other people in the car use their seatbelt? They may ask you about smoking in a car. You may think, why do they ask that? They want to know whether you're distracted. So there are going to be some questions that they ask. They're going to ask how many miles that you've been driving, because the more you're in a car, the more likelihood you're going to be involved in a crash, and insurance rates will go up. But more than anything, it's going to be, what is the crash rating of my vehicle? So these independent safety groups measure the trustworthiness of your car's frame, its seatbelts, its airbags. And if you're on a motorcycle, they look at the helmet that you've purchased and whether you wear a helmet or not. So today we're going to focus on safety equipment. Believe it or not, probably back when your grandparents had a family, or so basically when your mom and dad were around, there's a good chance that your mom and dad may have been in a car seat that looks something like this. And boy, has safety changed in the last 40, 50, 60 years. Now, there's a young child, I would probably imagine, under the age of a year and a half. That just scares me, looking at those metal bars, a little tiny, it looks like a clip that you would have on your backpack that is keeping her fastened there to the seat. It doesn't look safe at all. So we've come a long way. So what I want you to write down, who is the problem? Who is not wearing their seatbelt? And what we have found that young adults ages 18 to 24 are more than likely not to wear seatbelts than older age groups. We find men to be more likely not to wear it, and we could ask older men the reasons. It's kind of funny to hear some of the excuses. I'm a good driver. I don't plan on getting into an accident. I'm not traveling very far. I don't like how it feels. It's going to wrinkle my clothes, limits my mobility. These are some of the reasons that people give for why they don't wear a safety belt. I don't particularly think that they're good ones, but those are the ones that we hear. We also find that adults who live in non-metropolitan areas are less likely to wear seatbelts. So rural areas, they think that they don't have the traffic flow that you see in the city, or the bad drivers that you may see in the city. So it's safer, which isn't always the case. And then some state laws don't require it, or they make it a secondary offense. So people will say, I'll take my chances if I get stopped. It may be a $50 or $100 ticket. So that's not going to really kill me. I mean, this is for people that make a lot of money, and they may just choose not to wear a seatbelt. And we also have found that people sitting in the back of a car are less likely than front seat passengers to wear a seatbelt, making them more likely to be injured. And we're going to see a video on that a little bit later today. So what does the United States look like? And if you take a look at how it's basically in the color of shades of green, the very lightest states, and New Hampshire is one of those, they give you a range of 67 to 78% seatbelt usage. So we are in the lower tier. New Hampshire, and I was looking online today, has the lowest percentage of any state for seatbelt usage. I mean, look at the license plate that we have, live free or die. Okay, we live by that motto. And I'm going to show you something a little bit later where we're basically changing things a little bit. There's a possibility that the law will change this year. We just had a vote in February on seatbelt use, and I will show you that in just a moment. So in your notes, what I want you to write down, and this could be a test question, hint, hint, hint. What does primary versus secondary laws mean? So a primary law basically means that if you do anything, the examples that they give here, speeding, failing to stop at a red light, or a stop sign, you're going to get a ticket. You're going to lose your license more than likely as a young driver, and you're going to have to pay a fine. That is a primary offense. A secondary traffic law means that you were doing something wrong, like speeding, and they also saw something else going on, like you didn't have your seatbelt on, you were on your phone, you weren't, as a young driver, having the correct number of people in the vehicle. There were too many. So that's a secondary offense, and you're going to have to pay a penalty, loss of license, and probably a fine. Definitely a fine as a young driver. So what do the numbers basically tell us? Seatbelts reduce serious crashes, the injuries and the deaths by about half. That's the bottom line. We want people not to be hurt and not to die in their automobile. There is no reason. The way we're building cars now, the way we're building our roads, we talked about this 2 days ago with the HTS, it should be a rarity that someone is passing away in a vehicle going the speed limit. And that comes to something else. A lot of people say, if I wear my seatbelt or if I have a car with an airbag, will I always live? No, of course not. That's not true. I mean, if you're going 80, 90, 100 miles per hour, or you get hit by a tractor trailer truck, depending on where you get hit by that vehicle, there's a good chance that you're going to get seriously injured or you're going to die. So we are going to have deaths, but not at the rate that we're seeing them right now. We've got to see that rate going down. So what we're finding is that most states have gone to a primary enforcement law. That is making a big difference. That is why we're seeing the numbers starting to drop. And even though these states have primary laws, doesn't necessarily mean that people are following these laws. But if you're a law-abiding citizen, there's a chance that you don't want to get caught and have complications with your license, registering a vehicle, owning a vehicle, so you're going to follow the law. And that's what we want. Most people will do that. So what can be done? So let's talk about prevention. States can consider proven strategies for increasing seatbelt use. So as we just mentioned, making it a primary enforcement law, that usually shows an increased use and a reduced death rate over those states that just have secondary enforcement laws. It has to apply to everybody in the car, just not to the front seat driver. And the fines have to be high enough to make where it hurts. Okay, $50 isn't going to hurt somebody. $200 probably will. $500 probably will. What are we getting from our health professionals? What's the information they should do? Okay, they should remind people for doctor's appointments. They will always ask you, what is your risk taking? You know, smoking, drinking, seatbelt use. They're always going to ask questions to try to make you a healthier person. What can parents and caregivers do? They should set an example. They should use their seatbelt on every trip, no matter how short it is. If they have young children, they should be properly buckled in a car seat, booster seat, seatbelt, whatever is appropriate for that age. And we're going to talk a little bit about height, weight here in New Hampshire and putting kids in seatbelts or booster seats or car restraints, because there are different requirements for certain ages and heights. And you should know that. One, because you may have a younger brother or sister. Or two, once you get your license, you may get a job babysitting. And if someone's going to have you cart their kid around, you better make sure that you're taking every precaution to make sure that they're safe. So hopefully everyone will start to change their attitude towards the use of seatbelts. I'll be honest with you, when I was in high school and when I was in college, we didn't even have under age 18 for a seatbelt law. We didn't have one. So it was very common not to be in your seatbelt. Now, when I took driver's ed, yes, we had to have our seatbelt on in driver's ed. But I can remember my first job at the age of 21, 22. I worked at the Pease Air Force Base. And being on a military base, you had to have your seatbelt on. But I didn't really think that it was that important. So every time that I would go to work, I would put it on. But once I got off the base and I had to stop somewhere, the likelihood of me putting back on was pretty slim. There were a lot of times I would drive without my seatbelt on. And now today, because of the profession that I have, and because I so strongly believe in some of these safety measures, you will always see me with a seatbelt on. My wife gives me a hard time that when I'm just driving a very short distance, like just a half of a mile, or 2 miles to the dump, I've got my seatbelt on. I just do. And I signal my intentions all the time. You'll never see me not doing what I'm telling you to do because I want to set an example. I don't want anybody to come back to me and say, "Oh, Mr. Toll, I saw you without your seatbelt on or you didn't have your signal on." Okay, that you're just not going to see that. So here's a graph of New Hampshire, and this was through the CDC, and we hear a lot about the CDC right now because of the virus. So I was on their website looking at some of the information about the virus and came across where they had a tab where I could find out about seatbelt usage. So I quickly made a copy of this and put it in today's presentation. So from 2003 to 2012, New Hampshire has lost 919 people in vehicle crashes. Now, if you take a look at the graph, okay, where you have those tall vertical green bars, the national level is always higher that we have in New Hampshire. So, as I stated before, even though New Hampshire has a low usage rate for seatbelt use, we also have a low fatality rate for our seatbelt use. So it could be, like we said, New Hampshire people buy better cars that are protecting them structurally or airbags, or they could just be plain better drivers and they're not involved. But we also see that the number of people that are dying are more male than female. So this is a reason why insurance rates are higher for males than females. So if males are being injured more, dying more, the insurance company is going to have to pay out more money, hence a higher premium rate that you're going to have to pay. And there's the very bottom circle graph, the percentage of drivers and front seat passengers wearing seat belts. Okay, 86% nationally, 69% New Hampshire. So once again, okay, it shows that we just don't put it on. We just don't think it's necessary. This is what I was alluding to earlier. A bill narrowly passed the House committee, so it always goes through the House first and then goes to the Senate. So it had a vote of 10 to 9 through the Transportation Committee, okay, to make it where it would be a primary offense in New Hampshire not having a seatbelt on for people in the front seat. 30 states require rear seat passengers to wear restraints. We're the only one in the nation that doesn't require someone in the front seat. Okay, and then it goes on and talks about people that voted for it. Some thought it's going to save lives, others didn't think it was going to make that much of a difference. And then at the very bottom, they said, well, what are we going to do? Are we going to assess a penalty? And the penalty will be $50 fine for drivers and $25 for passengers not wearing a seatbelt. So remember, if this comes in the law, it's still a little bit of ways away before this happens. But if it does, this is going to probably be after you get your license. And part of information is to make people alert and aware of what is happening. So can you imagine your parents? Will they know that there's been a change in the law? Well, if they don't read the paper, listen to the radio or local news, TV news, they're going to probably miss it. So there are going to be people that will probably get stopped, maybe be given a warning, but maybe not. Maybe they'll just flat out give you a ticket for your first offense. And then the word will spread through your friend circle and your family circle. And that's how information gets pushed out into the general population by word of mouth, by people that you know. So let's just kind of take a look at the real problem. And I want to kind of show you, I believe this was state of Kansas did a thing. I think it was in a four-day period, six people died, which is pretty high. That's pretty high for a four-day period for a state like Kansas, which we consider a lot like New Hampshire, a pretty rural area.
Please consider your safety in your travels. Do you need to be on the roadways? How are you driving your vehicle? What are you doing to keep yourself as safe as you can for what can be taking place around you? Be safe, everyone.
Okay, it's pretty sad for a police officer or an EMT to come across a crash where there's a fatality. There are some things that you just can't unsee. And I think I mentioned the first class that I'm not one to normally show, you know, death on the highway. But today I am going to show you some images, just briefly, that may be a little disturbing to you. Of course, you know, once it comes on, it's going to be very brief. It's nothing, probably more than 3 seconds, 4 seconds, that you may see some blood. I know when we talk about motorcycle helmets, there's a head that's bleeding pretty bad. And the other thing I'm going to show you in a moment, and I think this is one of the biggest fears of a lot of people that are driving, it's not so much getting hit. And if you don't have your seatbelt on, you know, moving around inside the vehicle, even though you're probably going to get pretty banged up. But what's going to happen when you get thrown from the vehicle? And we're going to take a look at that in a moment. Okay, whether you saw that or not, you may have just thought it was debris being thrown up into the air, but that was actually a person. And maybe I'll go back and play it again so you can see it. But I believe someone hit the edge of the curb, and this is just me speculating what I think happened. I think somebody was on their phone, hit the edge of the road, overcompensated, and then there was a series of crashes. And one of the cars that was involved in the crash had the person go through. I'll show it one more time just so that we can look on it, because a lot of people normally, when I teach this in class and I show a person being thrown from a vehicle, they just don't see it. So let's take a look at it one more time. So if you take a look, oncoming cars, someone's going to catch the edge coming up. It's not what's happening in front of us. It's on the other side of the road. See that car? Now another car loses control and see, it's head on. And that is what caused the person to get thrown. The importance of everybody being in a seatbelt, and we were talking about primary and secondary, that you have to understand that if you have four people in a vehicle, two in the front, two in the back, and there's only one that's not belted, that person is still moving around inside the car and doing damage, possibly, to other people. So here we're going to take a look at a clip of what is happening in the back seat when people aren't buckled.
Seat. This family of three was thrown around when the cab they were riding in was hit by another car. In this video, the woman on the right is wearing a seatbelt. The woman on the left is not. And in the accident, she's thrown across the cab.
People are less likely to buckle up when they're in the rear seat.
Jessica Jermakian co-authored a new report from the Insurance Institute for Highway Safety. The survey found while 91% of people always use their seatbelt in the front, only 72% use it in the back seat, and that number drops to 57% when traveling in cabs and ride-hailing services like Uber and Lyft. Uber driver Dustin Goodsell says people often don't buckle up on short trips.
I usually will say something like, I noticed that you're not buckled. I think it'd be a good idea to be buckled.
Experts say riding without a safety belt puts not only the backseat rider at risk, but also people in front. In this test video, the person unbuckled in the back slams into the driver during an accident.
We know that drivers are twice as likely to be fatally injured when the passenger behind them is unrestrained.
Jermakian wants more automakers to install the same belt reminders cars have in the front seat for people in the back as well. She believes it could get more riders to buckle up and help prevent injuries. Chris Martinez, CBS News, Los Angeles.
Wow, New York, New Jersey.
Okay, pretty a glaring problem for people that think that they're safe with one person not belted, because as we see, it was pretty violent. Now, what I want you to write down in your notes is that even though you're in a seatbelt, your body is still moving. So this is based upon 150, 180-pound male going around 30 miles per hour. So what I want you to write down is that your head moves the furthest forward. It goes 1.9 feet. When you're going 30 miles per hour. Your chest goes 1.3 feet at 30, and your pelvis goes 1.2. If you've ever been in a car with your seatbelt on and you jerk the seatbelt very quickly, you know that it locks, but it first gives you a little bit of movement. Your body is gonna, with that inch and a half of movement, your body is moving this distance. So this is why airbags have to be put into play with seatbelt use. Because if we didn't have seatbelts, we may not be directly behind the airbag, and I'll explain that in a moment, and to have the full benefit of the airbag. So this is what a car would look like if it was hit on the side, and this is an older vehicle, probably 20, 30-year-old vehicle. but that car is just mangled. So someone's leg is going to definitely be messed up. Cars are built better now that we're not seeing that type of damage to the passenger compartment. We've got to protect people, and we basically got to put you like in a cage. And if you've ever looked at any type of professional racing, they basically have like a roll cage, extra modifications to a vehicle. It's just not something they take off a dealership lot and they're able to race. They've got to modify it to make sure that they're protected at going at those high rates of speed. So let's take a look at an airbag. And this is just a diagram of two people in a car, but know that there's a harness that can be adjusted up and down. There's a head restraint that you could tip forward or back. Then you've got your airbag with holes in it where the gas is coming out. So it deflates almost as quickly as it inflates, because if it stayed inflated the whole time, it'd probably snap your neck. And we don't want that to happen. And then, of course, to the front of the car, you're going to have crash sensors. And now they're even making airbags for pillars on the side of your car, on these posts. SUVs have them on the roof of a vehicle in case there's a rollover. And even we're having sensors when there are people approaching to the side of the vehicle, or if someone's been left inside a vehicle, like a child, and we're just trying to protect people as they drive. So this is actually from Australia talking about airbags. So
not only does it ruin your day, but it can leave you with serious injuries or much worse. A proliferation of people refusing to wear seatbelts in the United States back in the 70s led to car makers designing better safety systems to stop natural selection from wiping out a population. And they were called airbags.
Today, airbags are one of the most common safety features you'll find in a new car. But how exactly do they work?
In simple terms, airbags are tightly packed nylon bags designed to inflate within milliseconds of an impact occurring, stopping your head and body from hitting points around the vehicle like the steering wheel, windows, or other hard points, which can cause serious damage.
Sensors around the vehicle are able to detect an impact force, like another vehicle hitting yours, sending an electronic message to deploy whichever airbags are needed to protect occupants. The car is able to work out whether the impact is significant enough, as the force of the airbag deploying may do more harm than good in a low-speed accident. While early airbags were designed purely to protect the driver, most new cars have an array of airbags spread around the cabin to protect every occupant.
The Santa Fe we have here has six airbags, one in the steering wheel, one in the passenger side dash, one in either of the front seats, and curtain airbags that cover all three rows.
Again, because airbags deploy with significant force, you can do yourself serious damage if your arms get in the way or if you're simply sitting too close.
Once upon a time, the correct way to hold the steering wheel was at a 10 and 2 position. But driving instructors now say the best position is a 9 and 3, so the airbags have enough room to deploy without causing serious damage by having your arms in the way.
But there's more to occupant safety than just airbags. Cyclist and pedestrian detection systems are another important safety feature that you'll hear more about in the future. In the Santa Fe, it's called Side Exit Assist. If an occupant attempts to open the door while vehicles, cyclists, or in our case, someone on a skateboard is close by, the system will sound an alarm and in some cases prevent the door from being unlocked. The system also reminds the driver to check surroundings are safe before unlocking passenger doors. If you do open the door while a hazard is detected, you'll get this warning. Finally, we have child presence detection systems. So far, Hyundai is the first carmaker to introduce the tech, reminding drivers to check the rear seats before exiting the vehicle. It's called Rear Occupant Alert. The system uses sensors in the ceiling to detect movement after the vehicle has been locked. It stays active for 24 hours and will sound the car's alarm if it thinks you've left someone behind. If you've installed Hyundai's AutoLink app on your smartphone, you'll also receive a text if you haven't tended to the car alarm. Just as airbags can save you in the case of an accident, car makers are constantly developing tech like Side Exit Assist and Reoccupant Alert to prevent accidents happening in the first place.
Now, how cool is that? Now, when I first found this video, I had no idea of a rear occupant alert system. I still think this is something that they're probably moving towards the United States, so different countries have different requirements for their vehicles. But I think that is fantastic, especially when you read in the paper that parents have left their kids still in the vehicle when they've gone to work or left them. Well, it wouldn't help if they're on top of the car, but you should never leave anybody left alone in a vehicle. I wonder what would happen if you leave a dog in the car. I think the same thing would happen. And maybe that would prevent animals from, you know, overheating in the extreme heat where where owners have left them alone. So I think that's a super cool item to have in a vehicle. And I'm going to see if we have it here in the United States yet. But I thought that was so interesting when I came across it. Now, there are two terms that I want you to be familiar with. One is passive and the other is active. So when we talk about passive safety devices, we're talking about things that are done automatically for you. So this would be airbags. And on some cars, they have harnesses or belts that will come right across your body to lock you up. It's basically already attached. So basically, when you get in the car, it's kind of sitting or, you know, in front of you. So when you close the door, it comes towards you and it, you know, secures you into your seat. Now, active is where you're going to have to do all the work. This is where you're going to have to click your seatbelt clip. You have to use your shoulder harnesses, or if there's a combination belt, you've got to use that. And of course, if you're a parent, you're going to have to strap your kids in with their safety restraints. And we're going to see a little bit more about that and how to outfit a car, where to position kids in the back seat. So let's talk a little bit about airbags. This is what I want you to write down. No passenger under 12 years of age should be in the front seat. Now, if there is a mechanism to turn off the airbag, then it's going to be okay. Airbags are only effective if you're in your seat with your seatbelt on. So that means that if you're driving too fast and your body is moving towards the middle of the vehicle, there's a good chance if you were to get hit, your body's going to be facing the radio and not the steering wheel, and the airbag's not going to come out and deploy and be of full benefit for you. Of course, it protects against head and chest injuries, and this is important. I want you to write down a minimum of 12 inches. 10 to 12, it says 10 here, but 12, you don't want to be too close, because being too close, you're going to have some facial injury, and the bag isn't going to be as effective as if you had a little bit more of a space cushion between you and the airbag deploying. So don't get too close, but then again, don't be super far back or leaning back in your seat either. I'm sure if we were in class, and this is a question that I would ask people, how many of you have put your feet on the dashboard? So this I found, did you know that airbags come out at around 100 to 220 miles per hour? So if you ride with your feet on the dash, you may send your knees through your eye sockets. Now that doesn't sound too comfortable. It doesn't sound like it's going to feel too well. So let's take a look at a person that actually had that happen. Take a look at her forehead. That is from having her knees hit the top of her head. This is the way she is going to look for the rest of her life. That is a permanent deformity. I have no idea if there's brain injury that's involved in this, but that does not look like it was a good experience. Do not put your feet on the dash when you're riding in the passenger seat. It's just not safe. Basically, I went over this in my video if you watched it. If you didn't get a chance to watch it on YouTube last night, I really wish that you would. It kind of gives you a chance to take a look at the driver's ed car, but I talked about how to put your safety belt on and how to position it. So We're not going to go over that right now. These are myths and facts about seatbelt usage. And I just think as long as you focus on the facts. Actually, this might be a good way. Let me get back here on the screen here for a minute. Okay, what I want you to do, and I'm going to hold it up. I'm going to do it now, and I'm also going to do it at the end of the presentation. Okay, what you see is your homework. Okay, we're going to do a project. The project is going to be a poster where you're going to put two facts about seatbelt use or airbags or helmets. So choose one of the safety devices we're talking today, and you're going to make a poster trying to convince people why they should wear a helmet or what are the benefits of an airbag. So two facts. You could use things that we talked about today, or I want you to go online and find some information, some facts, some graphs, and it's going to be two colors, and it could be on just a regular piece of paper. So how do you get that to me? Just like everything else, you're going to take a picture of it. Take a picture of it and send it to me. Now, if you don't want to do the poster, do a radio ad. So you'd be speaking into your phone, record yourself, trying to convince people why it's a good idea to use your seatbelt or to have a car that has lots of airbags or a helmet. And then I put a star next to video. Video, two facts, has to be 30 seconds. But if you do a video, you get extra credit on your final. Okay? It'll give you some extra points if you just don't score too well to pass. Okay? So you get a couple extra points if you do a video. 30 seconds long. You could do it on your cell phone, edit it on your phone, or edit it on your computer since you're home. I figured this would be kind of a neat thing to do. So that's your homework. That's your homework for the weekend. So I'll put that back up. I may even text it out. And also, if you're not getting the group message, text messages, please let me know. I'm trying to get people the information the best way that I possibly can. And it's not perfect in any platform. So okay, let's talk about children. So here's the information that I need you to know. You could use this on your poster. Children should be at least 40 inches tall to wear a shoulder harness. How many of you, when you were younger, you took the harness and you put it right behind you? You didn't use the harness because it was uncomfortable. Remember, there's a mechanism on the side that will allow you to move it up and down. Anybody that's less than 6 years of age, less than 55 inches in height, should be in some type of a child passenger restraint. And anyone under the age of 18, it's a law, it's a primary law, needs to be in a seatbelt. So let's take a look at keeping kids safe.
More than 1,000 children 12 and under die in car crashes every year, and more than 100,000 are injured. But parents can reduce the risk to their kids if they put them in an appropriate car safety seat that's correctly installed in their vehicle. When a vehicle is moving at 30 miles per hour, so is everything inside it. If the vehicle crashes, unrestrained objects keep moving at their original speed until they strike the vehicle interior. This is why infant and child car seats are so important. They hold child passengers in place as the vehicle's front end does its job of crumpling and absorbing energy. This test demonstrates something parents don't even want to think about: an unprotected infant smashing into the instrument panel. Some parents think it's okay to ride with a child on their lap, but it's not. Crashes happen so fast and are so violent that you can't protect a child this way. Frontal airbags can be especially dangerous. In a crash, an airbag can hit a child or car seat with tremendous force. Even older children shouldn't sit in the front seat. The temptation to play with the radio can put them in harm's way. Children are always safer in the back seat. The basic types of car seats are rear-facing infant seats, forward-facing child seats, convertible seats that can be used either rear or forward-facing, and booster seats for children who've outgrown their forward-facing seat but aren't big enough for adult seat belts. Consider your child's age and size when picking out a car seat and whether it's compatible with your vehicle's seat and seat belts. Not all car seats will fit well into your vehicle. Proper installation has always been a struggle, but it is getting easier. Since September 2002, passenger vehicles are required to have special anchors, and most car seats have to be made with attachments that fit into them. This system is called latch. Lower attachments mate with anchors in the seat. Anchor points are usually marked. For forward-facing seats, top tethers get attached to anchors on the rear shelf or on vehicle seat backs. Car seats and vehicles without latch are still safe if you use the vehicle's belt system correctly. In order to do this in some vehicles, you may need to use a locking clip. Keep in mind, a car seat that fits easily into one vehicle may not fit very well, if at all, into another. Before you buy a car seat, try it in your vehicle to be sure it's compatible and can be tightly secured. Also, be sure to read the seat and vehicle owner's manuals to make installation go more smoothly. In some communities, you can check the installation at county checking stations, police or fire stations, car dealerships, or hospitals. If you're in a severe crash, inspect your child's car seat. If there's visible damage, you'll need to replace it. Remember, your child's safety is up to you. Always be sure he or she is properly buckled in without fail, every ride.
Okay, what I want you to write down in your notes, you have three seat belts in the back seat. You should always put a rear-facing child seat, an infant seat, in the middle. Okay, that is the safest place, especially if you're hit on the side. Because if you're hit in the side behind the driver or the passenger seat, the impact is going to be right where the child is. So putting them smack in the middle is the best place to put your one and only child, especially if it's an infant, like less than a year, because they've got to be facing backwards and not facing forward because their head's going to move. And then if you got more kids, then you can put them either behind the driver or the passenger. So who doesn't need to be in a seatbelt in New Hampshire? Well, if you're in a limousine, that's something that's transporting passengers, school bus, an antique vehicle or motorcycle, or if you have some type of individual education plan, if you're under the age of 18. So those people do not have to be in a seatbelt. So let's talk about motorcycle helmets. So we're talking about safety, and some of you may want to get a motorcycle license at some point, or you're going to encounter people on the road that are on motorcycles, and you want to make sure that they're safe. There is no helmet law in New Hampshire for those that are over 18. So make sure you write that down. But those under 18 and their passengers must use a helmet. Eye protection is a must for everybody. I don't think we're ever going to see a law in New Hampshire for mandatory helmet use. It's kind of ironic because I found an article here from a man that was in a rally in New York protesting the law that was trying to be passed about having to wear a helmet in New York. Well, during the rally, he lost control of his motorcycle. He went over the top of his handlebars. He crashed onto the roadway, hit his head on the pavement, and he died instantly. Not a very good, way to push the cause of why you shouldn't have to wear a helmet. And it's ironic. It's just the opposite. It's telling you why you should have a helmet. And it's just amazing how many people that don't wear a helmet or use the wrong type of helmet. So let's see what type of helmet should you be using.
A properly fitting helmet is your best choice to protect from serious or even fatal head injury. In fact, a head injury is the most common cause of death for motorcyclists. Helmets are most effective at neutralizing glancing blows rather than dead stop impacts. Thankfully, glancing blows are the norm in crashes.
But if you ran full tilt at a telephone pole, you would exceed the engineering limitations of even the very best helmet.
What we do know from the best studies that in the event of a crash, a motorcycle helmet will reduce your risk of death by 42% and reduce the risk of head injury by 69%.
Here's a breakdown of the areas on a helmet most often damaged in a crash. Studies have shown 3/4 of impact damage happens on the front of helmets. The front, visor and chin bar areas get the most damage, which means over 1/3 of all head injuries, primarily to the face, would not be covered by an open face compared to a full face helmet. This rises to almost 40% for a half shell. Standards and impact testing of all helmet types is incredibly important. We visited Crash Lab in Sydney to better understand the tests they do. The outer shell is the first line of protection. It works with the strap to keep the helmet on your head. It will flex in a crash and may crack. The inner impact absorption layer is the critical stage of defence. It's made up of EPS, better known as expanded polystyrene. The density and thickness of the EPS makes a huge difference to how well it cushions your brain. Newer helmets have low density EPS against your head and harder EPS against the shell, so a relatively minor impact doesn't give you a concussion. The strap is critical for keeping the helmet on your head in a crash. Helmets come off in around 11% of all crashes, which is frightening. This can also happen if the helmet is too big, even when the strap is done up. Proper fit is essential for effective protection.
I mean, it really is just conveying that a motorcycle helmet's going to stop your brain from bouncing around inside your skull when you have a crash.
Head injuries are horrible things, from mild concussions to death. All public health studies tell us that wearing a helmet improves your survival odds significantly.
Systematic reviews like the study that we did can't tell you which particular helmets are the best helmets to wear. But if you're wearing a helmet that fits you correctly and is appropriately standard certified, that's going to give you the best protection in the event of a crash.
So do yourself a favour and wear one. You know it makes sense.
Okay, like I said, I apologise for a little bit of blood. Hopefully it wasn't too bad for people. But actually, helmets do make a difference, and you can see that a lot of time and effort goes into testing to make sure that we have the adequate safety devices available to people to purchase. And we're going to see a video in a moment that is a heartfelt story from a survivor of a car crash, motorcycle crash, excuse me, and his story about not having a helmet or having a helmet, how it saved his life, even though he is severely injured. But it also talks about he made a mistake of not making good checks. One thing that you've got to realize when you're out on the road, motorcycles are very difficult to see. They're hard to judge their speed. So you have to be always looking on your guard for being around a motorcyclist.
Hey YouTube, it's Brian. Today's video I feel is very long overdue. Kind of wanted to talk about my motorcycle accident and more importantly the helmet that I was wearing in the accident. In 2009, I was pulling out of my work parking lot. I was pulling onto a fairly busy road and there was a bunch of parallel parked cars on the side of the road. So when I pulled out, I turned right and I didn't see an oncoming car that was actually speeding. And right after I pulled out, the road started to curve. So what happened was I pulled out, saw this car coming, floored the bike trying to get out of the way, and got a little too close to the curve, the actual curb of the road. And there were a bunch of trees on the side of the road, and I happened to tip the bike over against the curb and slammed headfirst into a tree. I was doing about 35 miles an hour, not anything crazy fast, but this is what happened to my helmet after the accident. As you can see, I caved in the entire top of the helmet. As a result, this broke my spinal cord, and from the chest level down, I'm now paralyzed. So I know you're probably thinking, you know, why would I want to listen to a guy who's paralyzed talk about helmet safety? Well, there's quite a few reasons. First being that I have zero brain injury. That was the biggest thing. My injury is completely physical, which has allowed me to do a lot of things. Obviously, I can still work. I co-manage a group of over 30 people. I can actually still take care of myself. I can take care of my bathroom routine. I can get myself dressed. I am fully independent. I'm married. I have a beautiful wife. I have a great job. I have, you know, a sports car. I like to autocross my car, which is a form of racing, and I do that quite a bit. I still work on cars. That's something that I've always really loved to do. So there's a lot of things in my life that I don't think I would have been able to do had I had a brain injury. As you can see, I wouldn't have even had that chance had I slammed headfirst into a tree. I would have been completely dead. There was no way that I would be sitting here talking to you today. I actually went through rehab with a guy who had a similar accident. He was going through an intersection on his bike. A car was coming through, ran a red light. He slammed into that car, flipped off his bike, and he didn't have a helmet on, and he hit his head real hard on the concrete. He was not the same guy that he was before. It basically knocked him back to third grade. When he was in rehab, he was tripping over himself. He was rambling. You know, he would just start talking, you know, gibberish. He just wasn't present. He wasn't himself. And that is one thing, the biggest thing, aside from my life, that this helmet has saved is my brain and my personality. When it comes to brain injuries, it can vary as far as what your symptoms are. It's all about where your brain was injured. So there's people who have lost complete memory. They actually have to write things down throughout the day to keep track of what they've done. If they went to the bathroom, you know, if they just anything throughout the day, they're actually writing it down. Their speech can be impaired. All these things are preventable from wearing a helmet. There's a lot of people who were married and they ended up getting divorced as a result of their brain injury because, you know, they might be very hard to take care of. Or the other thing is, since their personality is so much different, there's women that have said, you know, this isn't the same man that I married. That is one thing that I feel like I still have. I still have my personality. I'm still the same person. I can still joke. I can still do everything, you know, mentally that I could do before my accident. Obviously, there are some restrictions from a wheelchair, but I've overcome quite a bit of stuff. I even, believe it or not, I even modified my motorcycle to ride post-injury. It had little legs that folded down and a electric shifter. So what I would do is I'd push a button, the legs would fold up out of the way, and I would ride again. So that was one thing right after my injury that really kind of kept my mind out of the dark side. Obviously, I had a couple times where I thought about committing suicide. I didn't think that I could live my life from a wheelchair, or at least not have a quality, you know, life. I've found that that's complete bullshit. I have a great life. You know, like I said, I've got a great wife. I still hang out with friends. I still go on vacation. I still go swimming. I still do pretty much everything that I used to do. I just do it a little bit differently. So that's really all I wanted to share with you. I know people that ride motorcycles are extremely hard-headed. I was one of them. My accident, I thought, you know, if I ever got in an accident that I would break a leg or I would break my arm. I never imagined that I would smash into a tree and be paralyzed. But then again, if I hadn't been wearing the helmet, I would be dead. That would have been end of story for me. And I don't have the brain injury, like I said. So I can still do everything that I did before, just a little bit differently. Another thing I've still been able to do is watch my niece and nephew grow up. Just to see them from a little baby and, you know, the toddlers they are right now. to watch a child grow is just an amazing thing. I think, you know, if I was already a father, there's no way in hell I'd be on a motorcycle myself. But think about that. I mean, if you got killed, who's going to take care of your kids? And do you really want them growing up without a father, or growing up with a father with a brain injury who can't take care of them? I think that is the biggest reason. If you are going to choose to get on a bike, you need to get a helmet and you need to wear it. Don't have it strapped to the side of the bike as you're going down the highway. That's not going to help because anything can happen. That's one thing I've figured out. I took a advanced riding course 2 weeks before my injury. I mean, I was a safe rider. I did everything I thought I should. I wore the full gear, and stuff happens. I mean, it's just how it works, especially these days with everybody on their cell phones constantly. Accidents are everywhere around the corner, and if you're on a motorcycle, you don't have a cage around you. You're not in a car. You don't have an airbag. You're pretty much exposed to anything and everything on the road. So that's really all I wanted to share with you. If you have any questions, write in the comments below, and I'll talk to you soon. Thanks a lot.
Wow. What a story. What an inspiration. I think if he didn't have his mind, if he was affected with his memory, I think his state of mind would certainly be a lot different. But the other thing I took away from the video when I came across it was, I don't know if I'd ever get back on a motorcycle. That is just sick, to get on a motorcycle and not have use of your legs. Now, of course, they modify it, but man, if he tipped that bike over or one of those metal support bars didn't come down correctly. But I give him credit. He's still living life to its fullest, but he's only able to do that because he didn't suffer that brain injury. Let's talk about one more term, and it's called ramping. And what ramping is when you don't adjust your head restraint properly, so your head doesn't hit the back of your headrest squarely. So if you're a tall person, probably more males than females, but if your head has the ability to go over the top of the headrest, that is called ramping. Everybody right now, take your chin and touch your chest. I'm going to kind of go back. Let me kind of get out of this for a minute. Say you take your chin, touch your chest. That's a normal movement. But if you're to try to move your head back, see, your head still extends backwards. So the headrest is supposed to hit you right at the back of squarely on your head, and you don't go back any further. But if you were to move your head back further, all these muscles right here that you feel really tight will be ripped away from the bone. And when these muscles rip away from the bone, then there's a chance for a spinal fracture, a more serious injury. And think about it. The only way that your head stays upright is because of these muscles that are connected to your chin, to your collarbone. So if these get torn away, your head's just going to kind of bobble around. So that is ramping. And that kind of brings us almost to the end. Now, I'm going to hold this up again so people see it. I'll take a picture of this a little bit later, and I'll send it out to you. So remember, your project for this weekend is to cover something that we talked about today, whether it be seatbelts, helmets, or airbags. We know that it is going to be in our best interest if we protect ourselves and our passengers. And to inspire you to maybe do a video, I wanted to show you one of my all-time favorite videos that a student has done for me. And I actually had one more video to show you, but it's going to take too long. It's about 15 minutes long, and I didn't want to go that long today. But I want to show you the student video. So watch this.
All right, Violet, time for school.
Oh, choose some music?
Yeah, what song?
You know what.
It's the one and only Deagle Double G.
Snoop Dogg.
You know I'm mobbing with the D-R-E.
Yeah. You know the West Coast is back for all you suckers.
What? Suckers.
So put something in there. Put it in there. Yeah. Suck, no.
Top dog, by them all. Yeah, I'm burning it up. DPGC, you should be talking.
Now, they didn't use the two facts. I didn't, back when I first started doing this project, that wasn't included. It was just make a video that would kind of convince people to wear a seatbelt. So I do want you to include some facts so people start thinking about, wow, if this is really true, then I don't want to be, you know, on the loser end of not being in a seatbelt or having my helmet on. So I really thought that was a fantastic video. And I thought I would show that to you and hopefully inspire you. So over the weekend that you put something together, and if you send it to me, who knows, maybe I'll put it on so everybody can see it. So remember, poster, two facts, two colors, take a picture of it, you're good to go. Radio ad, 30 seconds, two facts, or do the video, which gives you extra credit. Monday's class, be here at 4 o'clock. We'll be talking about licensing. We'll talk about registration, titles, a little bit about purchasing a vehicle. So that's going to be on Monday. And I'll probably show you the video that we didn't have enough time to see today. But that wraps things up for today. So great job on your homework this week and tuning in. I kind of check in to see who's here. So remember, after this video is over, make sure that you sign out on your phone so I know that you are here at the very, very end. So have a great night and a great weekend, and we'll see you on Monday.